Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mission of Honor, A Moral Compass for a Moral Dilemma, by Jim Crigler, narrated by Shawn Compton. A young man needs direction in his life, and sometimes mentorship. When that is absent, his life can be like a feather in the wind. J.F. Crigler. Foreword. This book is the story of so many young pilots of that time. It took me back to those days over 40 years ago. We lived day to day in Vietnam, not knowing if we would see the next sunrise or sunset. It was a constant that we all just lived with. And like other combat veterans, we continued to live it to some degree every day of our lives. I first met Jim Crigler at Fort Walters, Texas, in the fall of 1970. We were warrant officer candidates in the 1st WOC training company. After primary training, it was on to Fort Rucker, Alabama, for instrument training and transition into the icon of the Vietnam War, the UH-1 Huey. We lived through the grueling inspections and verbal abuse designed to separate the weak from the strong. It was like forging steel. Jim and I were both honored and burdened with the mission of burial escort duty. It changed our lives forever. Seeing and feeling the grief of those special families up close was gut-wrenching, and it is still part of us both to this day. But it was our honored duty. The loss of our comrades in arms is ever present in our souls. Their faces will never age as ours have done in these 40-plus years. These men were our friends, people we ate and drank and laughed and cried with. They were in most cases men that we only knew for a few months or maybe a year. But these were men we would die for, and they for us. Even today, those who survived the war are the men that we still yearn to be around. All of the men we flew with in Vietnam took great pride in our accomplishments. For most of us, the tempering and fire in both flight school and combat has helped us excel in our lives. But when our time comes and we head to the great hangar in the sky, I'm certain that we will be welcomed by and know the faces that will greet us. Dennis L. Foucher, DDS, former CW-2 pilot, 129th Assault Helicopter Company. Introduction. Many books have been written about the Vietnam War. I didn't set out to write one of them. For me, the war was well behind in my life's rearview mirror, and I'd been looking forward for many years. But over those years, the war kept creeping up on me like a mosquito that keeps buzzing around your ear. It won't go away until it's satisfied with blood or you kill it. For 40 years, I let that mosquito buzz in my head. I focused intently on anything other than that war. But my life was impacted in many ways by Vietnam. I've had trouble with authority figures and people that did crazy and stupid acts. I live in seclusion at the back of a 200-acre wooded valley at the end of a mile-long road. There is only one way in and one way out. I like it that way. I work beyond extremely hard at every endeavor, whether it's work or play. 80-hour work weeks have been the norm for me for many, many years. I left the corporate world and started my own company because of this mosquito. But always my war would return. Then a few years ago, several of my grandsons asked if I would write some stories or perhaps a book about my time in Vietnam. They had read some books and discovered that helicopter pilots were key players in every battle of the Vietnam War. And they knew that was my job in Vietnam. I was a warrant officer helicopter pilot and flew the Bell UH-1 Iroquois, nicknamed the Huey. I agreed to try my hand at writing down my experiences. For 6 months, I would periodically sit down at my computer and try to hammer out my thoughts on the year I'd spent in Vietnam. But only a few stories came to mind, the rest blocked out by a brain that had shoved these nasty memories so far away that all I had was a blank slate. Many people I spoke to advised me to just start writing. They said it would all come to me. But it didn't come to me. I needed to remember what had happened and put it together so that it made sense to me. My mind was still a blank. Then one December day in 2010, I called my 82-year-old mother to see if she'd kept any of my correspondence from my time in Vietnam. Indeed, she had. Every letter. Some weeks later, I received an envelope with 14 letters I had written and sent to her from Vietnam. They were in a small stack with a piece of yarn tied in a bow around them. My mom had kept these letters as a memento for more than 40 years. All but one said free, where a stamp should have been. I went through the envelopes and organized them by postmark from September 1971 to September 1972, the time of my tour in Vietnam. But there was one letter left, the one with the postage stamp. It was dated December 5th, 1972, which was several months after I came back from Vietnam. Looking at my stack of letters, I decided I would start my journey of remembrance the next morning by reading my words from so long ago. There was a foot of snow in the valley, and the snowflakes were still coming down the next morning. It was not yet dawn as I started a fire in the fireplace. My wife and two youngest daughters were still asleep. I poured a cup of coffee and sat in front of the fire and grabbed the stack of letters. I decided to start from the back of the stack and go forward, so I opened the letter dated December 5th, 1972. I was curious why the letter was even in the stack to begin with. As I read the letter, my heart sank. These were the words of a very distraught young man. The letter was a suicide note I'd written in a fit of despair. I didn't remember writing it, but there it was in plain ink in my own handwriting. I wondered why my mother had kept such a thing, but I read that letter over and over. My stomach churned and my heart ached more each time I read it. Though I couldn't remember writing the words, I could still feel the pain. It was still there after all these years. Reading your own suicide note has a way of making you sit up straight in your chair. I was now more determined than ever to kill this mosquito. But there was much more to it than that. Chapter 1. We gotta get out of this place. Vietnam, Central Highlands, April 5th, 1972. Augie pressed his mic and said, "Take the aircraft, Criggs. I want you to fly the next sortie. We have two more supply runs into An Khe Pass outpost, and I need a break." "Roger, I have the aircraft," I said. I liked flying as co-pilot with Warrant Officer Augie Bailey. He was a brilliant pilot and an excellent teacher for me in combat. But today was a real shitfest. On our last mission into the An Khe Pass outpost, we saw bodies everywhere, including several still stuck in the razor wire from the previous night's assault by the NVA, North Vietnamese Army. We took small arms fire on almost every approach into that outpost. I flew low down the mountainside to our resupply pickup point. We loaded up with mortars, night flares, ammo, and water. The Korean RTO, radio translation operator, advised us that sporadic mortar fire had been taken at the An Khe Pass outpost since we left. The Korean company commander didn't want us to land on the helipad, but rather hover directly over his base and drop off the supplies. He needed that ammo desperately. Augie looked at me and said, "Screw that hover stuff. When you fly back in, I want you to be at a hover but moving forward while the RTO and crew dump everything out the back. It won't be pretty, but we'll get them their supplies." "Got it," I said. I flew back up the mountainside and low level along the ridge. I didn't do a textbook approach, but kind of a hot flare into the middle of the outpost, almost hitting the Huey's tail on a radio antenna as I flared. There were no Koreans in sight, as they were all hunkered down in their foxholes. This was not a good sign. "All right, get that stuff thrown out the back," Augie yelled in his mic. "Criggs, keep it moving forward." Just then I heard a whoomph as a mortar round hit somewhere behind us. "Keep moving, Criggs," Augie said. "Sir, this place is going really hot," shouted SP4 Gary Woodward, the crew chief. Whoomp, whoomp. went two additional mortars. All out, yelled Woodward. Criggs, get us the hell out of here, shouted Augie. I pulled pitch and nosed the Huey over to gain airspeed. We were in and out of that outpost in 6 seconds. That was close, I said. You did well, said Augie. Well, I'm glad you didn't notice how scared shitless I was, I said. Augie laughed. That's what it's like when you dance with the devil, Jim. Dance with the devil? How the hell did I ever end up in this place, I wondered. Sir, can we put on some tunes? Asked Woodward. Sure, Augie said as he tuned in the ADF radio to AFVN. Automatic Direction Finder Radio was an AM radio we used to home in on a beacon for flight location reference. AFVN was the AM station for Armed Forces Vietnam, and they played the most popular music of the day. Eric Burden and the Animals were singing, "We Gotta Get Out of This Place." The whole crew started singing along. I'm sure the Korean RTO thought we were all nuts. All we thought was, "We gotta get out of this place." Chapter 2. We All Start Somewhere. I was born the second son of Jim and Flo Crigler on February 2, 1950. My older brother, also named James, died shortly after childbirth in what was known at the time as crib death. Perhaps my parents' determination to name me James, as well, meant something special. I eventually became the eldest of 9 children. Until I was 12, I thought my mom was permanently pregnant. With an ever-growing family, we were constantly relocating from one house to another, and always changing schools. Our family life was anything but stable. My father was a dreamer, always starting new business ventures. Dad worked in construction, which was booming in the 1950s. He was Builder of the Year in 1958, when I was 8 years old. By the time I was 9, he was bankrupt. We moved from a nice home in a new subdivision to a rental house with no running water. Mom and Dad constantly argued, and Dad was frequently drunk during this period of my life. My parents had hit bottom, and we kids were right there with them. Though Mom and Dad did their best, we rarely had enough room or food or money. My parents often dropped me and my brother Mike at Mom's parents' house. Frank and Florence Feltmeyer were wonderful people. My grandfather Frank worked for Pittsburgh Paints for 35 years, and the family had lived in the same house since the 1920s. My grandmother Florence was a homemaker and devout Catholic who attended Mass daily. When we stayed with them, Grandma would wake us up each day for 7:30 Mass at St. Rita's Catholic Church. It was the most stable part of my life. My grandparents were a World War II Gold Star family, having lost their youngest son, Bill, on the beaches of Tarawa in the South Pacific in November 1943. Bill Feltmeyer was one of the thousands of Marines who died in that battle. During the war, families hung a red and white service banner in the window, with a blue star for each family member overseas. The blue star was overlaid with gold if the family member died, and the family became a Gold Star family. Mike and I spent most weekends and many summers helping my grandparents with their mowing, gardening, tree trimming, and everything else you can imagine. In the summer, Frank would show Mike and me how to plant tomatoes, trim fruit trees, and squish peppermint leaves between our fingers for that fantastic smell that lingered on our hands until we washed. He took us everywhere, and we saw how outspoken and confident he was in real life. And we watched him smoke cigarettes. Frank usually smoked about 3 packs a day. We sat together on many a summer evening and listened to Harry Carey announce the Cardinals baseball game on KMOX radio. Grandpa was content with Mike and me, and we were content with him. During the growing season, we helped Grandma make jam and canned tomatoes and other fruits and vegetables. We would stir and then lick the pots clean. Grandma circulated around the kitchen helping us, focusing on whatever recipe we were preparing. But she was a real character, too. Occasionally, she would cut a fart, and we'd all get a good laugh. There's more room outside than there is inside, she would say. Or, never trust a woman that doesn't fart. Going home from Grandma's at the end of those summers and reuniting with my parents and siblings was always hectic and chaotic. More kids, another house, Dad's new job, and there was never enough room. My mom, like Grandma Florence, was a staunch Catholic. My father never attended Mass except for weddings and funerals, but the influence of my mother and grandmother was strong. So much so that in my early teens I had quite an interest in the priesthood. My grandmother was always telling me what a great priest I would make. Several years later, at a retreat at a St. Louis seminary for potential priests, I ended my desire for the priesthood. During a discussion about celibacy, I asked one of the priests how difficult it was for him to remain celibate. He told me it was God's calling for him, and that I would have a sign if it was for me. Later that day, during Mass, I had one of those uncontrollable teenage erections that just would not go away. That was all the sign I needed. I would not pursue the priesthood. My dad continued to start new businesses, never quite reaching what he set out to do. The ventures always seemed to fail at the wrong time. When I was 12 years old, we were so broke that my mom went to the church for help. I'm not sure whether my grandmother had any pull with the priests, but St. Peter's Parish in Kirkwood, Missouri, put us up in an abandoned convent on Geyer Road. It was a godsend for my parents and paradise for us kids. The convent had 10 bedrooms and an 8-foot-high wooden fence surrounding 3 full acres. We lived there for 18 months while my dad got back on his feet. During that time, I played in the large yard, attended St. Peter's Catholic School, and was an altar boy at Mass many weekdays. I turned 13 while we lived in that convent and got my first job. I sold Sunday papers on a busy corner on Geyer Road. Dad was always absent, whether he was working or not. We saw him on weekends. I'm not sure how many jobs he had during this period, but there were many. He drank a lot as well. I suppose the pressure to provide for a wife and 9 children was pretty overwhelming, and my dad was definitely overwhelmed. In 1963, we moved to Jackson, Missouri. My dad had gotten a job through my grandfather and was working for Pittsburgh Plate Glass in Cape Girardeau. Jackson was a small farming town with a population of about 5,000. It was 6 miles away from Cape Girardeau. This was a big change from St. Louis for us kids, but we loved it. Amazingly, my mother was able to find a house almost as big as the convent. She met an old man who had an 8-bedroom house for rent. His name was Mr. Mueller, and he was the youngest of 9 children. After he met Mom and all 9 of us kids, he just had to have us live in his rental house. He charged us $100 a month and insisted we stay as long as we wanted. The thing about moving every year or two is that we had to learn how to make friends quickly, and we all did. My new friends were sons of farmers or daughters of workers at the Brown Shoe Company factory down the street. On weekends, we went hunting on the various farms. No pigeon was safe around us, and we knew where every covey of quail hid out. We also worked on the farms, especially during the summer, hay season. The farmers would make thousands of 60 to 70 pound hay bales that needed to be picked up off the fields, hauled to the barn, and stacked for the winter. We earned $1 an hour or 3 cents a bale, whichever was greater. 3 cents a bale was usually the winner. I liked working for those farmers. They showed me the meaning of work, and it was a great way to stay in shape. But it wasn't all work. Even though we started at 7 in the morning, there was usually an hour and a half break around lunchtime. The farmer's wife would set out a spread that rivaled any holiday meal I had known. There was fried chicken, ham, potatoes, coleslaw, and all the lemonade you could drink. And there was always cake or pie for dessert. Immediately after the meal, every teenager would plop down on the grass for a quick nap, then back to work until sundown, lifting and hauling thousands of bales in the afternoon. It was perfect country camaraderie, and by August, all of us were muscled up and ready for high school sports. I now understood how all the country boys on our football team were so strong. In November, tragedy struck. My grandfather died. His cigarette habit had finally taken its toll. I was grateful for his influence, but he died before I was old enough to ask him about the tougher questions in life. I'm sure he would have been straight to the point and given me clear instructions, but that was not to be. I was 13 years old. I still miss my grandfather to this day. Chapter 3. Small Town to Big City School. We lived in the house in Jackson, Missouri longer than any place else, about 4.5 years. I went to 3 different schools in Jackson, Immaculate Conception Catholic School, Jackson Junior High, and Jackson Senior High. In 1964, the Vietnam War was a regular nightly news topic, but at 14 years old, I had other distractions. The Beatles arrived on the music scene from England. I was an instant fan. In fact, I was the first kid at Jackson High School to wear a Beatles haircut. My dad hated the haircut. He also did not like the Beatles. He was a solid country music fan, and the Beatles didn't fit well with him. As my hair got longer, my dad got more disgusted with me. Since he traveled all week, it was only on the weekends that I had to endure his wrath. But my hair continued to grow. Finally, Dad had had enough. He sat me down and put a bowl on my head. "If you're going to comb your hair down instead of up, then we're going to make it easier to cut," he said. Boy, did I look silly. But I was so angry with him, I just left it the way he cut it. On Monday, I went to school and was an instant sensation. The girls loved it. Suddenly, I was a pretty popular guy at school. During my sophomore and junior years, I played football for the Jackson High Indians. I loved it. Being on the team meant wearing a letter jacket in school. I also lettered in track, but the guys on the football team were the big men on campus and had a lot of prestige, especially on game day. Our team was a close-knit group led by Coach Tim Lee. Coach Lee was one of those ex-college lineman football players that had no neck. He was all muscle. We all loved Coach Lee. I came into my own at football in the fall of 1966. While President Lyndon Johnson was talking about escalating the war in Vietnam and committing another 100,000 troops, I was playing offensive and defensive halfback for the Jackson High Indians, and I was pretty good at it. I was looking forward to my senior year, knowing that if I got good enough, I might just qualify for a football scholarship. I lettered in both football and track and was one of the top players on our team. It felt good to wear that letter jacket as I walked down the halls of Jackson High School. I even had my first crush on a girl named Vicky Gibbs. But as luck and life would have it, my dad decided to get a new job, which required relocation back to St. Louis. Halfway through my junior year, we moved to Hazelwood, Missouri. We went from a huge 8-bedroom home on 3 acres to a 3-bedroom ranch house on a postage stamp-sized lot. Our landlord in Jackson was devastated. So were Mike and I. There wasn't nearly enough room in that house for all 11 of us. So Mike and I built a room in the basement out of moving boxes. We also went from a small high school with about 500 students to Hazelwood High, which operated in 2 shifts of 2,000 students each. It was tough transitioning to Hazelwood. We had no friends except those we might meet on the bus on the way to school. I had a letter of recommendation from Coach Lee that I took to the football coach at Hazelwood. Coach Lee had done a good job on the letter, writing about my stamina and ability to play both offensive and defensive positions during the same game. I was pretty proud to hand that letter over to the coach at Hazelwood. I thought for sure he'd invite me onto the team, or at least let me try out. I don't remember his name, but he was a big muscle of a guy, taller than Coach Lee, but with the same no-neck appearance of a football lineman. He looked at the letter, looked at me, and then looked at the letter again. "Sorry, Jim, I can't use you," he said. "You're just too small. I'm sure that in your previous high school football division you were fine, but here I can only use the big guys. Otherwise, we get slammed on the field." He handed the letter back to me and said, "You should go out for track." I walked out of that office as dejected as could be. There went my opportunity for a football scholarship. I decided not to go out for track either. Looking back, it wasn't the right thing to do. I should have marched right back into that office and demanded a tryout for the team. But in this big new school, I was intimidated and didn't take that bold step. And I regretted it. This was a lesson I would remember later in life. But I made up my mind to settle into my new school and just make the best of it. Hazelwood High was more like a warehouse than a place of learning and growing. Two shifts of students and hardly any homework. In fact, I don't remember ever having homework. This was very different from Jackson High, where teachers pushed us to learn. I guess for the teachers at Hazelwood, it was enough just to survive the class sizes, much less grade lots of homework. During my senior year at Hazelwood High School, the Vietnam War was big news on television. President Johnson continued to throw more and more troops into combat. In January 1968, the North Vietnamese forces and the Viet Cong, their accomplices among the South Vietnamese, launched an offensive with 70,000 troops attacking throughout South Vietnam. The attack occurred on Tet, the Vietnamese New Year, and the press quickly dubbed the battle of the Tet Offensive. Thousands were killed on both sides. The North Vietnamese got the worst of it, with more than 10 times the casualties of the Americans. The United States had soundly defeated the North, whose military operations were now in shambles. The Viet Cong never fully recovered after the Tet Offensive, and it took the North Vietnamese Army until the spring of 1972 to recover. But the tide also turned with the American public, and anti-war sentiment was prevalent in the United States. The North Vietnamese had won a public relations victory. The Paris peace talks continued to drag on. It was obvious that the American public was tired of the Vietnam War. Even so, there were patriotic young men still willing to serve. I personally had no thought of joining the military, as I wanted to be the first in my family to get a college degree. But one thing was on my mind, as well as the minds of all the young men about to graduate: the draft. I knew many guys in high school who signed up for various spots in the Army, Navy, Marines, and Air Force. Many enlisted before graduating high school. Some who joined did so to avoid being drafted into the Army or Marine Corps, which were considered the bullet stopper branches. Whereas, in general, the Navy and Air Force were considered safer positions. At least, this was the sentiment at my high school. Not everyone planned on going to college, and if you didn't have a college deferment or a physical disability that would keep you from serving, you were subject to being drafted. At 18 years old, we were all required by law to register for the draft. I was pretty aware of the national news for an 18-year-old. I had a keen interest in the freedom marches that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. conducted. I had never seen the type of racism that the nightly news talked about in the South, and it intrigued me that Dr. King was using Gandhi's peaceful, nonviolent methods of protest. We had learned about Gandhi's revolution in high school, and I was in awe that we were seeing the same thing in the United States. It ended in April of 1968, when Dr. King was murdered in Memphis. It seemed like chaos would continue during my entire senior year. I'd never had a steady girlfriend up until my senior year. That's when I met Diane Pastors on a double date. Man, did I fall head over heels for this girl. We did everything together: drive-in movies on Friday nights, date nights at the indoor theater, or just meeting at a hangout to talk. A favorite was our local Steak and Shake. Kids would drive their muscle cars through the lot and around the circle, before finding a spot to park for some fries and a cherry Coke. It was always fun hanging out with Diane. Unfortunately, Diane's parents were going through some tough times. Her mother was an alcoholic and was constantly sipping vodka. I'm not sure whether they just thought I was not the right guy for their daughter or their personal trials spilled over on Diane, but they let it be known that Diane was not available. They restricted her to the house and didn't let her drive the car, and they screened all the phone calls I made to her. But we still managed to meet anyway. I even asked her to my senior prom. We just could not stay away from each other. The more her parents restricted us, the more we tried to get together. Young love is blind. In many ways, her parents were right to be worried about their daughter. Any parent would worry about a young son or daughter at this stage of their life, but the alcohol and ensuing divorce would cloud the situation. In May of 1968, I graduated from high school, having no idea what I wanted to do next except go to college. I sat down with my parents to talk about how to finance my schooling. They were adamant that there was no money for college. Dad said, "You don't need college, son, just look at me." Frankly, I did look at him. That was a big reason my heart was set on getting a college degree. But without money from my parents or a scholarship, I had only one alternative: go out and work and make enough to pay for it myself. I found work at a local car wash and gas station repair shop. I was making $2.25 an hour, and I was pretty excited. I even bought a used car. It was a red 1966 GTO convertible. It had three deuces, two-barrel carburetors, a 389 cubic inch engine, and a four-speed transmission. So much for college savings. In June, more chaos erupted. Robert Kennedy was assassinated while campaigning in California. This was pretty upsetting to me. It was the third assassination in 5 years in the United States. At 18, I was not able to vote, but if I could have voted, Bobby Kennedy would have been my choice. Oddly, I was old enough to be drafted and fight a war, but not old enough to vote. 3 years later, Congress changed the law and lowered the voting age. The Vietnam War continued to escalate. Chapter 4. Draft Bait. I worked as much as I could during the summer of 1968. I washed 30 cars a day, pumped gas for the customers who drove up to the pumps, and helped the main mechanic, Jim Stubbs. You didn't talk back to Jim Stubbs. If he told you to do something, you better get it done, or you got the wrath of Jim. He did not put up with slackers. I regularly worked 60 to 70 hours a week across 6 days. It was exhausting work, and I relished my Saturday night dates with Diane. Sundays, I usually slept most of the day. Then, starting on Monday, I would do it all over again. Between car insurance and gas, I had little left to save for college. But living at home in a room made of boxes in the basement meant I had no rent. That helped. At the end of the summer, my parents moved, this time to southwest St. Louis County to the town of Manchester. This made it more difficult to get to work, but it was still cheaper than renting an apartment. I worked and commuted for a year. By the end of that time, I had saved a grand total of $300. It wasn't enough to get me into any university, but it was enough to start out at a junior college. Merrimack Junior College cost $125 per semester, plus books. I enrolled for the fall semester in 1969 at Merrimack. I got a job working part-time at Spirit of St. Louis Airport, which was a lot closer to home and convenient to school. On the plus side, I was able to learn a lot about flying and even got to ride with the State Patrol helicopter. College was a totally different experience than high school. There was homework, and lots of it. My classes were made up of students who had just graduated high school and military veterans going to school on the GI Bill. It seemed like the Vietnam War was everywhere. Life magazine, Time magazine, every newspaper, and every nightly news program carried stories about the war. It was impossible to get away from it. There were anti-war marches in Washington, D.C., and it seemed like every major city had a protest march. After the Democratic Convention in 1968 in Chicago and the subsequent rioting, the protests continued to escalate. And nowhere was there more discussion and change taking place than on college campuses. Along with all the upheaval over the war, the sexual revolution of the 60s was in full swing. Free love, flower children, hate Ashbery, love-ins, the pill. Old models of waiting until marriage were being replaced with liberation and experimentation. It was all too much for a 19-year-old boy to take in. After the first few weeks at college, I settled into a routine. I went to my classes, then to the student union to study as much as I could. After that, I went to work, usually the 3 o'clock to 11 o'clock shift. Gradually, I noticed more dissent on the Merrimack campus, and the war protests got more visible as well, especially in the spring when the weather warmed in St. Louis. In the outdoor common areas, public debates were staged, with many students opposing the war and veterans taking a position supporting the war. These talks got heated, and at times I thought that fights would break out. Though fists never flew, there were a lot of demeaning comments and hurt feelings. Both sides tried to justify their opinions, but it seemed like neither side budged. Our campus was as divided as our country was. I made friends with many of the veterans on campus, especially those in my classes. I was also friends with students who were opposed to the war. Many times I was asked to join protests and burn my draft card. I never did. I thought the veterans on campus were pretty good about those protests. They had done their duty, and now they were allowing the freedom of speech for which they served to play out. I never saw a veteran publicly get angry at draft card burning protesters. In the spring of 1970, the country was on fire. Most of the veterans I knew weren't combat veterans. About half served in Germany or other areas in Europe. Some served in the United States. But about 30% were Vietnam vets. Many of those had seen significant combat as well as atrocities committed by the Viet Cong and North Vietnamese. They had a look in their eyes that was different than the other veterans. You could tell they were survivors. They wouldn't talk about their experiences for fear of being singled out as a killer of innocents. These men were impacted the most by the lack of respect.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.